everyone, Aaron here for Zolotech, and today Apple released iOS 14 Developer Beta 5. Now, this is out to all iOS 13 supported devices if you're using the Developer Beta, and expect the public beta either later today or, based on what they've done in the past, in a couple days at the most. So let's go ahead and take a look at the size of it. We'll talk about how it performs, battery life, and much more. iOS 14 Beta 5 is pretty large in size. As you can see, it was 1.82 gigabytes on my iPhone 11 Pro Max, and on every device I installed it on, the iPhone 7, the iPhone SE, and the 2020 iPad Pro 12.9, it was over 1 gigabyte for each device. So this is a pretty large update. Now let's take a look at the build number and then the new features. You can see the build number is 18A5351D, and this particular update should bring quite a few bug fixes. At least there's quite a few mentioned I'll talk about later. And the first thing that they've updated or fixed is a modem update. So if you're having connectivity issues, whether that be with your 11 Pro Max or something else, they've now fixed that. So if you go into your settings and then go to About, under About, if you scroll down, you'll see that the modem firmware is updated. In this case, it's 1.50.25. And this particular modem update hopefully fixes any connectivity issues you have. Now, the first new feature or change has to do with widgets. Now, they've already fixed the widgets, so the time and the weather should be updated according to what it actually is now. But there's a new widget in here as well. So if we scroll down quickly, edit, add a new widget. If we go down to news, under news, there's a new size. Now, it's kind of odd how it's working, but you'll see it's kind of duplicating everything, but there's a huge size now. So if we add this widget, you'll see there's a giant widget. Now, the odd thing is we cannot move this widget to a home screen. So if we try to move it over to, say, a blank home screen, it won't stay there. So they've added that widget. It stays put under widgets, so maybe they'll add it so you can add it to a home screen later, but now we have a larger size. We may see this with future widgets as well. One other thing that they've actually changed with widgets that may or may not be a good thing is when you enable dark mode, so we'll turn on dark mode here, you'll see that the calendar widget is actually slightly gray as opposed to completely black on the previous version. So there's a slight color difference, and that means it won't save as much power because those pixels won't be turned off. So hopefully they'll change that back later on, but compared to the previous version, it's no longer pure black. Now, another new thing has to do with the weather widget. And the first time you go into it, it's going to ask if it's allowed to use your location. So it says, will you allow me to use your precise location? Allow once, allow while using the app, or don't allow. Now, this is actually a setting in your settings now as well. So if you go into settings, and we'll go back so you can see where it is. But if you go into settings, scroll down to privacy. Under privacy, go to location services. Under location services, scroll down to whatever app or widget you want to use. Go into that and you'll see it says while using the app or widgets. So there's a new option for that just for additional levels of security and privacy. So it's nice that they've added that. Now within Control Center, they've updated the home widgets as well. They've changed the size. And as you can see, there's an odd gap here. I've tried to get rid of that gap and it won't go away for some reason, but it's there. But in the previous beta on the left on my iPhone XR, you can see that it actually has larger home widgets. They've changed this and better organized the home widgets so they make a little bit more sense on the right. Now, why there's a blank space between my widgets and the others, I'm not really sure, but I'm seeing this across multiple devices. So even on my iPhone 7, for example, I've got the same gap there. I know not everyone has this. I've tried turning off the home features, turning them back on, and it's still showing up that way. So I'm not really sure what's going on there. It's not a big deal, but it's sort of separated them, and maybe it's on purpose. Now, when you go into the clock, they've changed it so the clock wheel is back. So maybe you want to edit an alarm. We'll edit this one. In the top here, we can actually scroll and change the time. Now, it's not exactly the same way it was before. So if you tap on it, you can input the time you want, but you can actually scroll here in these small icons and change it to whatever you'd like. So if you tap, it's hard to see there, we'll tap on the one side, and then we can change the first hour, tap on the second side, and then you can change that. So they've updated it. I'm glad they brought it back. I would still rather have it down here, but let me know what you think about that in the comments below. Now, if we go into photos and we go down to albums, you'll see at the bottom, there's no longer a hidden folder option like there is in previous versions. And so that doesn't mean that it's gone, but they've simply removed the option and moved it into settings. So if you go into settings and then you go down to your photos here, We'll find it. We'll go into photos. Under photos, you'll see that it has hidden album. And if we turn that back on, go back over to our photos, we've now got the hidden album back. It's a new option. I'm not sure why they did it that way, but it's updated so that you can turn it on or off. And your hidden photos stay in there. So maybe even if you don't want that to say the word hidden, that's why they did that. Now, there's another feature when it comes to exposure notifications. They've changed it again. So again, that's under its own category. Go to exposure notifications, and now you can turn them on. Before, you couldn't turn them on unless you had an app that wanted to use it. So if you go ahead and turn it on, it will tell you that you can turn it on based on where you live. So if we hit continue, you can select your region and turn it on based on region. So it's all over the world. So for example, we'll find the United States here, and then you can select your state and so on. So if you want to turn it on that way, you can do that and then set it up for whatever app your state or local authority has. So it's nice to see they've implemented it that way. Again, it's off by default if you don't want it on. So it's nice that they've implemented it and you can actually have some control over it now. Now, another thing they've changed is when you're using picture in picture. So if you're using it for a video or maybe a TV show, so we'll go into TV. And maybe we'll play this movie. Now, when we have picture in picture enabled, we can move it around like before. So you can move it around and just like before, but now you only have two size options again. So for example, on the old version, if you double tap, you can change between three different sizes. On the new one, you've got two different sizes. So let me set this down. And if you double tap, you've got two different sizes. You can no longer have an in-between size. So hopefully they change that. I'm not sure why they did that, but you'll see we can fill the screen sort of. On the old one, we had a middle size as well. So I wish they would give us that option, but they took it away for now. Maybe we'll see it a little bit later. Now there's a new splash screen as well if you open Shortcuts for the first time. And you can see it has a couple new icons. It says Shortcuts for Watch, Automation Suggestions, Starter Shortcuts, and Compact Design. So it's just telling you what's new if you haven't seen this before. If we hit Continue, and then maybe we want to create a new shortcut, maybe we'll add an action. A bunch of icons appear to be missing as well. So they will need to fix this in future updates. So it's kind of odd. Media and web and favorites, documents, locations, they're all missing icons for some reason. So hopefully they fix that in the future. Now with iPadOS, there's not really anything new, at least that I was able to find, other than what I've already mentioned. So it seems to be the same as far as features or anything else. So don't expect any major changes other than bug fixes and things like that. So those are the major new features so far, but there's a bunch of bugs that have been fixed and some bugs remaining as well. So they've resolved 23 bugs in this particular update, according to their notes. So one of them has to do with mail. Mail should be working properly with the exception of some exchange authorizations. So if you're using Microsoft Exchange with mail, then you may have some issues. Everything else should be fixed now. So it's been working okay for me so far, but it may not for you. I'd love to hear from you in the comments below. Also, if you're using AirPods Pro and you were trying to use your camera, that should now work properly. I know it was a problem for some people, and it should be working as expected when they're connected now. So if you were having that issue, it should be resolved. Also, many people were having issues with the keyboard, that messing up. People have said that's been fixed, and also many other things throughout the OS. Now, other than all of the fixed issues, there's still 36 known issues remaining. So Apple is still working on this, and one of the issues is Siri Suggestions still works even when it's turned off. So if you go into your settings and you physically turn off searching or suggestions while searching, it still gives suggestions. So for example, if you search for Apple, it gives apps and everything else. So this is a known bug. They'll probably fix it in future updates. And it may not have been an issue for you before, but so far this is better than beta 4. Also, widgets don't seem to close into the right place on the iPad. So on the iPad Pro, if I open settings and then swipe it home, it goes back. But then other times it doesn't go back into the right place and it will sort of flake out and not work properly. So if I go into Geekbench, go back, swipe back in, again, it's working okay here, but for some people that's not working properly. Now, battery should be better than the previous version, although we don't really know at this point. As Apple continues to fix the bugs within the OS, it should help with the optimization of battery. So if we go into battery, you'll see my battery health is at 96% still. Again, that only goes down based on the degradation of the physical battery itself. The update won't cause that to go down, but you'll see over the last 10 days, my battery was not so great. So We'll go to yesterday, for example. I got 4 hours of screen on time, 3 hours and 9 minutes of screen off time with about 50% usage. This isn't really great for me. 10 to 12 hours is about normal. So hopefully it improves greatly with this particular update. I'll let you know in a few days with a follow-up, of course, and I'll do a poll and everything else so we can determine whether or not it's the best one to use for you. Now, also, performance seems to be pretty solid. Over the past hour or so, as I've been using it before this video and things, iPhone 7 and iPhone SE seem to be performing okay. After they stopped processing in the background, everything seemed to be nice and fast as far as scrolling and going through different menus. It seems to be reacting like you would expect. And so far, again, I've seen no lockups or freezes. That doesn't mean it won't happen in the future, but even things like opening the camera, snapping a picture, everything feels nice and fast. Now, I did run a Geekbench on all of these devices. Let's take a look at some of those. So if we go on to the 11 Pro Max, let's go over to Geekbench here. I had to run this a few times because it was actually doing quite a few things in the background, but the third time was the best one, and you'll see I scored 1,331 for single core, 3,225 for multi-core score. If you take a look at the history, it's not going to be that great. Like I said, I ran it three different times, as you can see here. And so based on the previous version, if we take the highest score now, it's about the same for multi-core, give or take, it's a little bit less, and slightly higher for single core. So overall performance should be pretty good, and these numbers can go up over time. Now let's take a look at all of these devices. On the left, I have the iPad Pro 12.9 from 2020, then the iPhone SE, the iPhone 7, and the iPhone 11 Pro Max. All of these scores seem to be pretty typical of what we had before. So if you're using one of the older devices, like the iPhone 7 or even a 6S, you should have decent scores compared to what you had before, but hopefully you see a lot less lockups. Now, the question is, should you install iOS 14 Beta 5? And the answer, in my opinion, is always yes, but especially yes this time, because Beta 4 was the worst of the betas, according to most people. It had multiple freeze-ups. I had to close and reopen Twitter multiple times. I had problems all over the OS multiple times. I've had to reboot it, and it got worse and worse the longer I used it. In fact, if I was to do another follow-up now on it, I would say it's definitely the worst out of the iOS 14 betas. So beta 5 can only get better at this point. And again, I'll do a follow-up in a couple days to let you know how it's going based on hundreds of comments and thousands of votes. So if you have any suggestions for those votes, I'd love to hear them in the comments below. Now, as far as iOS 14 beta 6, we may be on a weekly schedule at this point. So in the calendar app, for example, we could be on a weekly schedule and see it as soon as the 25th with iOS 14 beta 6. So we may see a few more and then the GM or Golden Master prior to the final release, probably in late September or early October, based on what we're seeing as far as iPhone 12 releases. So it's really hard to say exactly what they're going to do, but based on previous versions, this was the time we switched into the weekly mode of releasing betas. So hopefully we see that again, and we have a new one next week and the following week, maybe a couple more, maybe up to beta 7, and then a GM after that. Although again, they can change this at any time. That's it for iOS 14 Developer Beta 5. Of course, if I find anything else over the next few days, I'll have a follow-up video with more new features as well, like I normally do. Now, if you'd like to get your hands on this wallpaper, of course, I'll link it in the description like I normally do. And if you haven't subscribed already, please subscribe. And if you enjoyed the video, please give it a like. As always, thanks for watching. I'll see you next time.